Hello, this lecture is about transformers, a special kind of neural network architecture. And the scientific application of transformers was called Attention is All You Need. And therefore, also the lecture is called Attention is All You Need, How Transformers Change Deep Learning. The story of transformers started with a very famous publication of here several, mainly Google scientists, in 2017, and this paper, which is called Attention is All You Need, has received over 30,000 citations. So it's a very prominent paper with a lot of applications. And given that usual scientists might receive only a few thousand citations, you can imagine how this single paper had an impact in the field of natural language processing and on AI in general. As the name already indicates, the focus is here on attention in the sense of how to implement attention in an AI sense. We will come back to this later on. To better understand how transformers emerged and how transformers differ from other neural network architectures, we can have a look again at these different neural network architectures which have been proposed in the past. Mainly, we can mention here the convolutional neural network, CNN, also the long short-term memory, LSTM, or then the advanced as bidirectional, so bi-LSTM, or generally RNN as a kind of neural network architectures. And then we will go more into the details of the transformers themselves. When we have a look on RNNs, so recurrent neural network, the idea was, as we have seen in the last lectures, given an input XT to produce an output HT, given some internal state representation A. So the idea is now how to represent this A. If we unroll this over the time, so we have at timestamp zero, we have here the output H0, then at timestamp one, we have output H1 and so on. Yeah, this is what you know. The problem here is a little bit that this architecture is quite simple. We can see here internally, we just have here a tangent symbolicus function, which combines the output or the input, sorry, XT with the previous internal state of A. Another disadvantage of RNNs is that RNNs do not capture long-term dependencies and they fail to keep the context. So what do I mean here? If we look, for example, at H3 as output, it's very hard for an RNN to backpropagate and to say, this output H3 depends mainly on the input X0 and X1, because internally you just have the tangent symbolicus function and you mainly can just indicate to the neural network that something here in the past you need to change, but maybe not where and so on. And so this leads then also to the problem that if you have long sequences, for example, long sentences, maybe whole documents, it's very hard to determine what is the output here, if you think of machine translation, for example. The solution back then in the 1990s was then the long short-term memory, short LSTM, which were actually not reinvented, but rediscovered more around 2010 and so on, so quite late, but they have actually been proposed quite early, these LSTMs. And they are a special kind of RNN, and they have been designed to learn more these long-term dependencies. And how does this work? Well, first of all, we can say compared to an RNN, which only finds the locally deepest value, LSTMs remember more all these values and finds the globally deepest value. This is at least the idea. And they solve this by having a more complex internal representation, as you can see here. We do not only have here the tangent symbolicus or here, but you have here different sigmoid functions, different combinations of the internal state, and then different gates. So you have here a cell state CT, which is always transmitted from the previous state. So here CT minus one gets into the current state, and then this new state CT gets into the next state at timestamp t plus one. And the second idea was here to have different so-called gates. So the input gate, which indicates what of the input is relevant for the output, then the output gate, what do we really submit for the output, basically, in the forget gate, that sometimes we always need to forget things. Yeah, I do not need to explain here the details again, but I can directly jump to the cons, so the disadvantages of LSTMs. The one disadvantage is that it inhibits parallelization. As we have seen here, the output, for example, at timestamp t always depends not only on the input xt, but also the state ht minus one. And for computing ht minus one, I need to go back to ht minus two and so on until h zero, so until the beginning. So I have O of n, which is not really good for parallelization. And as we will see, this is also solved in the transformer. We have here a distance of O of one, but I will come back to this later on. Second point, which is more on a conceptual level, is that there's no explicit modeling of long and short range dependencies in the case of LSTMs. So I still only have here this transmission of this cell state CT minus one to the next one and so on, but I do not really have wires to the different states here, I can say, and so on. And finally, disadvantage is also the distance between the positions. This is linear, so O of n, which means that too long LSTMs perform quite badly. So it's similar to the other points. It's just that if I have very long sentences, you can think of the input might be 512 tokens, and then I have a lot of computation to do, and does not really scale that well. There have been some variations, not really solutions, but variations. For example, the bi-LSTM, bidirectional LSTM, the idea was here to do not only do it in one direction, but in both. This is quite good, for example, in the case of text, because the text on the right-hand side might also be decisive for the current state, I can say, not only on the left-hand side. So the whole context is more important. Then GRUs have been proposed, gated recurrent units. This is a special way of LSTMs, we can say, where one gate was removed. I only have a reset gate and an update gate, which makes the whole computation a bit faster, more efficient, but the performance is often or sometimes the same. It really depends on the task. And then I can say there have been some early works on attention later on, so around whatever, 2000, 2010. There have been some works on the so-called attention in the sense that we still focus on the encoder-decoder architecture. So I have the encoder, which encodes the input. For example, here some sentence in Chinese, and I want to translate it. So I want to output here some English sentence now, for example. And when I'm at the decoder, the first step, then the idea of attention is that I have a look basically on all these encoder states and so on. And I can, and the neural network knows that in this case, for example, it should look mainly at E0 or E1, so this is most decisive, and so on. Whereas in the case of, for example, at the end, the most decisive representation of the encoder, the last token was here, also at the end, and so on. So being it more flexible and having this different degrees of links of weights between the encoder and decoder. So this is basically attention. There have been some early works, but transformer is now on a new level, we can say. Here the focus is fully on attention. It's not only using recurrent neural networks, convolutional neural networks, LSTMs, bi-LSTMs also, but a new neural network architecture. Here's the abstract from this scientific publication, Attention is All You Need. And relevant is here, for example, the sentence, he proposed a new simple neural network architecture, e-transformer, based solely on attention mechanisms, dispensing with recurrence and convolutions entirely. So this is a high expectation, we can say. And by the way, I can also recommend to read this article, Attention is All You Need, which is available online, because it's compared that or perspective that it's written by very high quality researchers at Google and so on, it's written very clearly, do not mention these details, but really focuses on the most novel parts so that also researchers and PhD students, master students can deal with it. One part of how to deal with that I do not need really depend on recurrence and convolutions anymore is the so-called self-attention mechanism. And what do the authors mean here? They mean here that a mechanism that relates, as they say, different positions of a single sequence in order to compute a representation of the sequence. So this basically means that, self-attention, first of all, is also often named intra-attention, so that the items in the sequence know each other, we can say. What this means exactly, we will have a look later. Self-attention has already been applied for several tasks before the transformer, this reading comprehension, abstractive summarization, so different things, mainly in the field of NLP, as you can see here, natural language processing. And now transformer is the first model relying entirely on this self-attention. Let's have a look how this works now. First of all, it's a sequence-to-sequence model labeling, or sequence-to-sequence labeling problem. So we have, as in the case of machine translation or text summarization, we have as input some text, so different tokens, different positions, position 0, 1, 2, and so on. You typically start with 0. And the output is similarly also some sequence source, some symbolic information. For example, the same sentence, same document in a different language. And internally here, now you have this neural network architecture, the transformer. And this deals not so much with the symbolic information as we can see here, but with subsymbolic information, maybe embeddings, matrix multiplication, and so on. First of all, the design choice of these Google researchers was that they still use the encoder-decoder architecture. Encoder-decoder was that I have here my input, I get it into the encoder. The encoder is responsible of encoding the stuff which it gets. So having good internal representation of this. And then it gets to the decoder, this information, and the decoder is responsible of producing the output basically. And regarding the formulas, the input is often this X, the output is the Y, and then this internal representation, which is often subsymbolic information like vectors, matrices, and so on. This is often named as a set. Now it gets already slightly more complicated, but not that much. The authors say, let's only not use one encoder and decoder, but several of them. And they came up with a stack of 6 identical encoders, as you can see here, and 6 identical decoders. Identical in the sense of that the architecture is the same. Of course, the internal representation, weights, matrices, and so on are different. So in this way, we can already model more complex behavior, more complex information. If we have a look now at the different encoder and decoders, we can say that regarding the encoder, it consists of two main parts. First of all, there's the so-called self-attention. Is what we all talked about, this new part I will talk about later on. And then we have a feedforward neural network. So feedforward neural network is quite old-fashioned, I can say. Nothing really new, but here the new part is here the self-attention. And by the way, the dimension of the model is typically 512, as they at least mention it in the paper. Depends on the implementation, of course. Then let's look at the decoder. The decoder is responsible for producing the output and uses the information of the decoder. And therefore, it not only contains the self-attention and the feed-forward neural network, but also an encoder-decoder attention layer. So this is an attention layer that helps the decoder to focus on the relevant parts of the input. How it does it also in a second. Here's the full transformer architecture. Maybe you have seen this figure. So this is from this paper, Attention is All You Need, quite famous. And let's have a look on it in more detail. First of all, we have here the input, and here you have the output probabilities at the top. And then on the left-hand side, so here you have the encoder, and here on the right, you have the decoder. And as I mentioned, the encoder contains this attention mechanism, multi-head attention, it's called here, and a feed-forward neural network. And in case of the decoder, you have the multi-head attention network again. Here, multi-head attention again, because this is here exactly this encoded decoder attention. You can see here also the link to it. And then again, the feed-forward network. There are some also some small details, adding the norms, some regularization and linear projections and so on. Also positional encoding and so on. We will come back to this. And it's also not so important for the main understanding. Let's have a look now at the input embeddings or the input. Here we have the input. So we, for example, want to translate one sentence in another sentence in another language. And the question is, how do we do this? So first of all, the idea was, yeah, let's use word embeddings again. They are typically pre-trained embeddings already available, which means if we have some word che or whatever, then we have some internal subsymbolic representation in the sense of a vector x1, here's u, is x2, and so on. What is the dimension? Now, this is a question of the implementation, of course. In the paper, they also mentioned 512 dimensions. So it must just fit to the overall architecture in the sense that if you have here the input embeddings, here the encoder and later the decoder need to deal with this dimension or the number of dimensions, but otherwise this is flexible. And also the authors have experimented with different dimensions. So conclusion is here, let's just use word embeddings, nothing too special. And we have here now the embedding, then gets at the encoder step, first to the self-attention. The output is then some internal representation, also a vector. And as I mentioned, this is now typically called set. So here, set one, set two, and set three, for example, for these different tokens. And this is then forwarded, so it gets into the feed-forward neural network. The output is then also some vector, which is then forwarded to the next encoder. So which means that you have here, you start here with the token, you first get the embedding, you have this internal representation set one and so on. You get another embedding, which is often called R here. And this is of course not anymore the initial embedding of the word, but here this output of the first encoder. And you have several of them. We talked about here this six identical encoders, six identical decoders. So you have here these different states, which are then, or different vectors, which are then forwarded all the time. And in this way, you have a very complex or different kinds of representations on a syntactic and a semantic level. Let's have a look at this self-attention. Self-attention was here now these components of the encoder and decoder. So this very first step, we can say. And self-attention allows now to look at the different positions in the input sequence. So we have an understanding of the other relevant words, we can say. So here, for example, we have it. And then we can ask, what does this it refer to? And so the as you can see here, it could refer to the animal, but it can also refer to the street or whatever. And so the transformer is here learning these different syntactic and semantic structures. And the idea is to do this fully automatically. How is this self-attention now realized technically? And this is the first great idea of this attention paper of these authors. It's a scaled dot product attention. So you have so-called queries, keys, and values, shortened with Q, K, and V, of your dimensions DK, DK, and DV. You first kind of merge this Q, the query, and the key, do some matrix multiplication, some scaling, masking. This is especially relevant for the decoder, not so relevant here. So this is mainly that at the decoder, you only have the information you already know and not what will come in the future. So you have some masking. And then with the softmax, you earn some weights between 0 and 1, and it sums up to 1. So that's a probability then. And then you can multiply it with the V and you have this attention then. In more detail, the first step of this scaled dot product attention is that you have the inputs, like here, the tokens, thinking machines, for example, again. You first get the embeddings, x1, x2. This is what you already talked about. And now you get the queries, the keys, and the values. How do you do this? Well, simply with matrix multiplication. So you multiply here this embedding, for example, x1, with a matrix WQ, Q for queries, and you end up with Q1. You do the same with x2, x2 times WQ, you end up with Q2, and so on. These are your queries, same with the keys, and then here the values. Why do you do this? Well, simply because matrix multiplication is quite efficient. There are some special, also hardware, or at least some good algorithms for this. So this is no problem. What else do we need? Second step is then to calculate this score. We can also call this an attention score, some kind of weighting. Which words depend on which other words, we can say. So each word in this sequence has some dependency on other words or some relations. And you do this with a dot product of the query vector with the key vector of the respective word we are scoring. So here we have the score Q1 times K1. So with the first token here, thinking Q1, K1, then you get some value. And you do the same here for these different tokens. So you have this n times n, basically. You have here then K2, so the dependency of thinking to machines and so on. All right. Third and fourth step is then some kind of normalization and gaining this probability value. First of all, you divide by 8. Why divide by 8? This is the square root of dk. Dk is this dimension which needs to be chosen. As I mentioned here, this you need to have the dimension or the number of dimensions dk, dk, and dv. For example, 64, and then you end up with 8 as the square root. This is what the initial authors also took. So then you have here some values, and then you just compute the softmax. Softmax is normalizing it in such a way that they all end up with the sum of 1. So then you have direct probabilities, and that's always very good. Then next steps, step 5 and 6, is then to multiply each value vector by the softmax score and to sum up the weighted value vectors. So so far we had here the softmax scores, and then you multiply it with this value. Values come from here above. And then you get some sum, set 1, set 2, and so on. And that's already it. So as I talked, this set are now these internal representations which you get after applying this this self-attention. In reality, you have these different words. And as I said, matrix multiplication is very efficient computationally. So what you actually do is you deal with matrices. We have the input matrix X. This is a representation of these embeddings of the input. So here, first token, second token, and so on. So you multiply it with this matrix WQ, then WK, WV, and you end up with Q, K, and V. So these are now matrices. And then the other steps, step 3, 4, 5, 6, is just one big step here, mainly a softmax of this matrix multiplication divided by here this number 8, for example, times this matrix V. And then you have directly this matrix set. Yeah, so far so good. Second kind of novelty, and which also revolutionized this field, is the so-called multi-head attention. So second invention of these Google authors. And what's the idea here? The idea here is to make this now a little bit more complicated, in the sense that we need several of such operations, we can say. So we need more complex attention. So the idea is to linearly project the queries, the keys and the values, namely H times. So here we have V, K, and Q. They have linear projections, so nothing special. And then we also do this scaled dot product attention several times. The authors initially thought of 8 times, is also still often used. So which means you have 8 different kind of representations of here this input and so on. Why do you do this? Not only because you have a more complex representation and therefore a more complex representation of this input of the text and so on, and therefore have a different representation of these different semantic concepts, but also that you can do this in parallel. So you have seen here already, for example, here you have seen that everything goes from down to up, but nothing from to left or to right and so on. So this is quite efficient because you can just do all these things here in parallel. And similarly, also with this multi-head attention now, you can do this scaled dot product attention for these 8 different dimensions, let's say, in parallel. Why do you do this multi-head attention overall? Because it expands the model's ability to focus on different positions. So if you have the sentence, the animal didn't cross the street because it was too tired, then again, this multi-head attention learns what it refers to. Is it the animal? Is it the street? And so on. Secondly, multiple sets of query key value matrices I have written here. So what do you mean here is that you have here these different representation subspaces. I will have a visualization for this later on. How does this work now, this multi-head attention? Well, basically it's just doing this several times and in parallel. So you have the attention head here of number one. So this is our first one, second one, and so on. You just typically start the numbering with 0. And the new point is here just to have this several times. So here 0, 0, 0. Also multiplied then with this matrix W0Q, W0K, and so on. And you do this H times, so 8 times, for example. At the end, you have now these different attention heads. So what was really important, the output basically of this set 0, set 1, until set 7 because you have H times 8. But now, we come back to the picture here. It continues here with one line, you can say, for linear, and here concatenation. So you need to merge it somehow again. And so this is too large for one single feed forward neural network, FNN. We need to combine it somehow. The different ways of combining this now, we can do the average, for example, majority or whatever. The solution the authors came up with was to use a special weight matrix WO and multiply it with this matrix response in another small matrix set. As I said, matrix multiplication is quite easy, so this is just another learning step. Some overview. We have here, first of all, the input tokens. These get into the word embeddings. So now we have this matrix X. You multiply it with this W0Q, W0K, W0V, and these different dimensions, 0 until 7. So as you can see here, then you calculate the different attentions using this K, Q, K, and V matrices. You have the different sets. You multiply it with this W0 and you finally have this set value and you're done then. Good, sounds quite straightforward. Let's have a look at how this works now. I wanted to explain how this, especially multi-head attention, works. And we can have directly a look here on the right-hand side. if we have the attention from input to input again, and we have here the token it, then we can see that, yeah, first of all, we have here this different representation, which is learned by this multi-head attention. We have here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So basically, these are these 8 different dimensions, we can say, the 8 different multi-head attention layers. And yeah, this is just the dimension of the network. What we can see here is that it sometimes has a strong emphasis on different words depending on the dimension. So sometimes it's here, here, for example, more the street, sometimes more here, the animal, and so on. And this highlights that different syntactic and also semantic information is learned during the learning during the, or in this neural network architecture. So it seems to work quite well. And this is not accomplished by other neural network architectures previously so far. If we have a look at the full transformer architecture again, we now had now a close look on the multi-head attention, which is here and here, also here in a similar way. What is left is now a little bit this feed-forward network and the positional encoding. Let's have a look at the feed-forward network. First of all, feed-forward network, FFN, we already know, nothing special, still quite popular, often to be used at the end of some neural network architecture. It's used in the encoder and decoder, or decoders, as I said, and we basically have here two linear transformations with a ReLU activation function in between. So we have here this X. This is basically what comes from this multi-head attention. We multiply it with some new matrix W1 plus B. This is some bias. Then we get the maximum. So this is then the this ReLU activation function, and then multiply it again with W0 plus B, and this is then the output. So nothing too special. Interesting is also the number of dimensionality. So the dimensionality of the input and output is 512 in the original paper. It's the default value, but can vary a lot. And the dimensionality of the inner layer of here, this feed for neural network, is 2048, so larger, as we can see here, because of bring up some computational power, more complexity in it, but it's still reasonable, no problem to solve this. W1, W2 here have different parameters from layer to layer, but they have the same across the different positions. Now let's talk also a little bit about the positional encoding. What do I mean here? If you look back at the architecture, the positional encoding was at this step here, also here. And this has been introduced to tell the transformer or this neural network architecture at which position in the input I'm actually am. So I have these different tokens, I have these vectors, so I do not have the sequence, but I need to, or I want to keep this sequence to some degree, but do not only want to use some bag of words model where the sequence is not important. And now I could have different possibilities. I could add some indication at which position I am, for example, some one-hot encoding that I have a vector which says, okay, if I have a one at the first position, then I'm in the first position. And if a one is at the second position, it's the second step, and so on. Problem is, I might have a lot of steps, and this is also, does not scale so much. And I do not only want to represent the absolute position, but maybe also the relative position, that I want to know, okay, at this step, this was 2 times before or after some other step, and so on. To conclude, this is not the main focus of this lecture here. To conclude, there have been some works about this position encoding. And the idea is that you have here the input, then you have the embeddings, and you have here some positional encoding also as vectors, as embeddings, and you just sum it up. So finally, here some sum just works, and you have an embedding with a time signal. So you just change these embedding of the tokens to some degree. Here's the actual formula which is used for these embeddings of the positions. You do not need to learn this by heart for the exam. What you need to know is just that you have here some sine and cosine which is used, and you have here that some different lines, you can say. So this is how it looks like, and this is how you can encode both the absolute and the relative position. If you're more interested in this, I can recommend you, there's some nice online blog posts like here and here. All right, so coming back to the overall idea of attention and also of transformers, what you see here is an analysis regarding the complexity, which is also mentioned in the paper. Attention is all you need. And what you see here is a comparison of self-attention, so basically of the transformer neural network architecture with recurrent neural networks, convolutional neural networks, and so on. We have different dimensions here, namely the complexity per layer. Here we can see that, you might think this all looks quite similar, but in reality, n is here the number of the sequence lengths, and d is the representation dimension. Often n is smaller than d, and therefore this is quite smaller than this one. So, which means that self-attention is more efficient than the recurrent neural networks, for example, regarding the complexity per layer. Second aspect is here the sequential operations. What is meant here is the amount of computation that can be parallelized as measured by the minimal number of the sequence operations required. And you can see here that this is an O of one instead of O of n. So a huge improvement, you can say, regarding the operations. So this is basically that, as I said, that you have here nothing where you need to go to the left and right, but you can always forward this information directly through the encoders and decoders and so on. All right, and the last dimension or last aspect is here the maximum path length. This is the maximum path length between any two input and output positions in the networks composed of the different layer types. And you can also see here that here the self-attention is much faster, we can say, than the recurrent neural network, also a bit than the convolutional. Overall, the selling points of the authors of transformers was that it's more efficient, it's faster, more effective, it achieves state-of-the-art results, so even better results when it comes to tasks like machine translation and so on, and it's more interpretable. I will come back to this in a second. So more effective, so state-of-the-art results, you have seen this since some years, for example, Google Translate and so on has improved a lot, at least I would say so. And one reason for this is that transformers are here used in the backend. It's more efficient, so faster. This is so mainly about the training times and so on. Of course, not so much the testing, just applying it. And more interpretable refers to the fact that you have these multi-head attention layers. And as we can see here, you can have a better representation, visualization, and indication what was relevant when, for example, some sentence was translated in another one. Then you know, this was an error because it had the wrong link, for example. But the area of explainable NLP is still a hot topic, and this is not considered here so far. Some words about the initial training and evaluation of these authors. So they published this 2017, and they had one machine with 8 GPUs, and only, we can say, training time was between 12 hours and 3.5 days. So according to their writing, not so much. they often train these huge neural networks for several days, weeks, and so on. They use the more or less standard things like atom optimizer, residual dropout, label smoothing, which we did not talk about. So this is more about preventing overfitting and overconfidence and so on. You can check it yourself. So conclusion is here, nothing special, but still quite effective. And nowadays, also specific GPUs have been proposed, which you can also use at Google Colab, for example. These TPUs, they have been proposed more for training these transformer architectures. So they are specifically designed for these kind of neural network architectures and for example, these matrix multiplications. Transformers have been used widely nowadays so far. I mentioned already machine translation. You can also think of document summarization, document generation, a quite interesting topic, I would also say. The idea is here that you do not only have so-called extractive summarization, so you have sentences and the neural network need to determine what are the most important sentences, which, when they are put together, reflect the whole key content, but also generative text summarization gets more and more popular with transformers. So here's the idea is that you have some input, some long document, and some new summary is generated, for example, an abstract of paper and so on. And this abstract is also, the sentences are not written in the text per se, but it's everything is newly generated. So it's kind of magic. Then we have named entity recognition. Also in specific fields like biology, we have sequence analysis, quite important. Transformers are more and more used also for images and texts and videos, also in IoT for time series prediction, more and more outperforming also CNNs and so on, interestingly. Having a look at some literature, so this is only a few works, not really representative. If you want to have a thorough study of transformers, I can recommend you this survey here. And then you can see here that some variations of transformers have already been proposed in the last years, like reformer to make this more efficient, longformer, because so far this initial transformer model only was capable of having 512 tokens and as input. If you have longer texts, what to do would be a question here. Then funny ideas as transformer in transformer and so on. And the last two literature references are indications how transformers are used in real world use cases, for example, for e-commerce recommendation and also for time series forecasting. So for example, of predicting the time series of electricity consumption and of the weather and so on. As I said, now going more and more from the field of NLP more and more to other fields. This was now a short introduction into transformers. If you want to know more about it, I can recommend you here first of all this YouTube kind of tutorial, a short lecture about transformers. Similar style as I have just presented, I guess. Then we have here the Jupyter notebooks. They are provided directly from Google and so on. So this is more about trying it out on with TensorFlow. It's relatively easy, I would say. And then you have here some possibilities of visualizing this attention to get a better understanding of visualizing the transformer in general. And there are many other tutorials online. That's it from today. Thank you for your attention. I hope you like transformers now. As I said, it's still a state-of-the-art technique in many areas. Some new technologies are now popping up, but still a very important cornerstone with a huge impact on NLP and other AI areas. In this sense, have a nice week. See you next time. Goodbye.